Kia ora, welcome back. As expected, former Air New Zealand boss Christopher Luxon has put up his hand for a political career. He's seeking the National Party nomination in Botany, East Auckland. Whether he gets it or not, and let's face it, he probably will, with the likes of John Key singing his praises, the battle for Botany is going to be one to watch next year. The incumbent, former Nat Jami-Lee Ross, fell out with his party a year ago this week and is determined to stay on as an independent. Whena Owen met up with him to find out just how he plans to do it.
I want to show you and show you some people I've met and helped over the years.
It was exactly a year ago this week that Jami-Lee Ross was dumped from National. Now he's gearing up for a face-off with his former party and parading his successes around the electorate for Q&A.
Hey, Colleen.
Colleen Wright's a big Jami-Lee Ross fan.
Good, how are you?
He helped save her local park from the developers.
I don't think we could have done it without him.
She's also a long-time National supporter. No worries, says Jami-Lee. She's representative of how he thinks Nats in the electorate can use their candidate and party votes.
If Colleen wants to see a National government, I'd say, Colleen, vote National, but also you can have the best of both worlds and you can vote for me as your local MP too.
He's inspired by others who've survived the switch to independent.
Peter Dunn and Winston Peters and O'Hara and Tauranga are probably the best examples in recent memory.
But Colleen Wright is struggling with that idea.
He could easily be the National candidate. Him and Simon used to be wonderful friends.
Do you want them to be friends again?
Oh, yes, it was years ago, but it was.
Are you ever
wonderful.
Going to be friends again?
Well, T. Howard Towers said that you could make up.
Look, I think unfortunately Simon and I had a falling out. And for him and Paula, they are working so hard to see me leave politics because it's personal for them.
Last week, the people of Botany were told the former boss of Air New Zealand, Christopher Luxon, has put his name forward for selection to be the National candidate.
He's well known and I feel he's got a good brain and he'd be ideal.
Luxon comes from a very corporate background and you're obviously using the National ticket to get into politics.
So would you vote for Chris Luxon or Jami-Lee Ross or someone else?
Jami-Lee Ross.
Jami-Lee Ross?
Yeah.
I guess Jamie has done a lot of things for Botany. You can actually see some of the things he's done, but he's got a challenge on his hands as there are probably staunch National supporters in this electorate.
It's not the first time a celebrity candidate has been involved in this area. The last celebrity candidate that tried to win a seat in Botany was Maggie Barry, and I beat her in 2011.
Last election, Jami-Lee Ross won Botany for National with a 12,839 seat majority. Botany is growing fast. Just over half of the people in this electorate were not born in New Zealand.
You've got the very strong ethnic Chinese and Indian communities.
With suburbs bordering Ōtara in the south and upmarket areas like Cockle Bay in the north. And that's where Jami-Lee is taking us. He's working with locals and Labour ministers to try and save the dwindling Cockle population.
If I was still a National MP, I would never be able to work with Stuart Nash. I would never be able to work with Phil Twyford. I'd never be able to work with those Labour ministers because the blue team and the red team never work together. But now as an independent, when locals come to me with issues, I can actually go in and pitch in and advocate on their behalf.
Jami-Lee Ross?
I think his chances, personally, are slight.
So why Jami-Lee Ross?
He's a good person.
I will stay with Jami-Lee.
I'm Labour Green.
Labour and Greens haven't confirmed their candidates for Botany. Apart from this incumbent, only one other is confirmed. That's the new Conservatives deputy leader, Elliot Ekelay. Back at the park with Colleen, I wanted to know if the MP for Botany was really considering his future.
You must be thinking about your options, though, if you don't pull this off.
I'm focused on doing the best job.
It would be a disaster.
Thank you, Colleen.
Well, you know, Christopher Luxon, he might be one of those ivory tower people, but he doesn't connect.
So will Christopher Luxon get his chance to make that connection? National will confirm next month. Meanwhile, Jami-Lee Ross will make the most of his head start.
Goodness me, Colleen is a staunch supporter. Right, we're back with our panel now, Ben Thomas and Josie Bagani. Ben, I'll start with you. National's candidate selection is next month. Do you expect the delegates in Botany will toe the line and vote in Christopher Luxon?
You never know without getting in there because, you know, you can't just direct electorates to do your bidding. you know, that's how you get offside with your long-serving party members, the ones who have been out there leafleting in the rain at, you know, car parks, and who have already had to put up with quite a bit with Jami-Lee Ross, and Pansy Wong left under a bit of a cloud before him. So, you know, you might see a bit of a surprise. In the end, I don't think it matters. If you put up a withered pot plant with a national rosette on it, it would beat Jami-Lee Ross next year.
Yeah, although Colleen just wants him to make up with Simon Bridges, so he's got a problem right
there.
If that's his supporter,
necessarily happen any time.
No, so. I don't think so.
How do you think? How do you think Christopher Luxon has handled this so far, Josie? Do you think that, as Ben suggests, that some National Party members in Botany might prickle at what could be perceived as direction from on high?
Probably, but I think Christopher Luxon's a very different candidate to Maggie Barry. I mean, Maggie Barry was a, you know, TV personality. Christopher Luxon is a credible candidate and a credible potential leader of the National Party. You can't get around that. I mean, he's been the head of Air New Zealand, but also he's been involved with the NGOs, and that's quite... I read somewhere where he said he didn't know whether he was going to get into politics or run an NGO. Well, he's on the board of Tear Fund, one of our members, and he's been an influential person, and he's deeply involved in that. So I think he's quite genuine. So I do think he's a threat. The problem is, though, for National, that he comes in the election. If he'd come in a by-election, so say they'd got, I don't know, Nathan Guy and Ōtaki to stand down early, run a by-election this year, you bring in someone like Christopher Luxon, a candidate that could potentially be a leader, and then you have at least the possibility of doing a Jacinda close to the election and saying, right, you know, Simon Bridges isn't cutting it, we'll bring in a hero and a sort of star. Now, might fail, he might not be that candidate, but I think they've sort of snookered themselves. You get the feeling that they're kind of going, we'll pass this election and we'll concentrate on the next one, and then we'll bring in Christopher Luxon as the leader.
Ben, what do you think of the relationship between Simon Bridges and Christopher Luxon? Because clearly some people are already pinning a future leader title on Christopher Luxon. Is that the sort of thing Bridges will be anxious about?
Future leader is a terrible badge to have in politics. You know, if you contrast the way that Christopher Luxon has entered politics, you know, if you could say he's entered yet, it's very different to say John Key. John Key came in a very unassuming way. He worked the room, he met all the right people, but he had this kind of effect that whenever I met John Key when I was maybe 23, 24, and I came away thinking, I'm the first person who's spotted his potential. Other people need to wise up to how good this guy is. And of course, everybody in the room was wandering around thinking that. Whereas Luxon, you know, it's been a bit of a klaxon call. It's been a bit louder, probably a bit more ostentatious. I don't think that's the best way to sort of, you know, start off. And I think leadership talk is very premature.
With all due respect, the National Party leading commentators are all saying that about Christopher Luxon. So you sort of think he must be a threat, right, to the leadership now, because.
Seems unlikely that he'd be making a play for a wee while just yet, though. You would expect him to have at least a term in Parliament or a couple of years under his belt. I wanted to ask you both about the local body elections. Woeful turnout across the board. But let's start off with what was probably the biggest result, and that was, of course, Andy Foster being elected and Justin Lester.
What do you mean? I'd like to congratulate the new mayor of Wellington, Peter Jackson.
Do you really think? Do you really think that made much of a difference?
No, I don't. I think what made a difference, and I come from the Wellington region, what made a difference is that none of us can get to the airport on the roads that are clogged, and you know we're a bit sick of being told that we can go to the supermarket and drop the kids off at sports using rapid mass transit. Transport.
Well, I found it very interesting speaking with Phil Twyford today, and you know, he said he feels like there's been a bit of a sea change, and that people are supportive of, you know, of denser housing and higher intensity housing around the country. I mean, look at Andy Foster's central policy. You know, he has opposed the Shelley Bay development, which is mainly apartments and townhouses.
Everybody supports intensive housing around the country, but not in their neighbourhood.
Yeah,
that's why local government in New Zealand is a basket case. That's why it's disappointing. Pointing to hear Phil Twyford say that the new Urban Development Authority won't be riding roughshod over councils and bypassing the RMA, because it needs to. Now, David Parker can be noodling around with his comprehensive RMA reform as long as he likes, but so far the RMA interim reforms that they introduced last month actually make it harder to get intensive developments.
I think one of the things about, I mean, talking about local elections, and we've had a low turnout. Now, that's not because people aren't educated about you know, elections. It's because there's not enough to get them out. They don't think it's worth their while. And I actually think if you were going to devolve a whole lot more responsibility to local government, whether it's housing. So, you know, the urban development stuff, it's some good stuff that Phil Twyford's saying, but actually the problem is social housing. That's what we don't have enough of. There's still this kind of, I think, a challenge with problem definition for the government, that they haven't really analysed what the problem is with housing. And it's not really helping middle-class kids get into houses, even through, whether it's through Kiwi Build or Urban Development Unit or whatever. It's actually, if you gave councils council housing, you gave them the resources to do the social housing, I think you'd make a huge difference, and people would get out and vote for things like that.
All right, we have to keep moving. Kia ora kōrua. Thank you so much for your time and insights this evening. Ben Thomas and Josie Bagani on the panel.